event was brought to you by our planning committee, which is Mike. Raise your hand, Mike. I'm Lisa. We've got Gina in the audience and James. James is over on the camera there. And, ooh. Where'd my TV go? I love that technology. Okay. So, Cleo, you were also part of our team. Cleo in the back. And who did I forget?
Rhonda.
Oh my gosh, how can I forget Rhonda? Thank you, Rhonda. Rhonda was helping registering everybody this morning. So while we work with our technology again. 2 seconds. Okay. Good thing we got a lot of prizes this morning. So, 804.
All right, well, good morning. Thank you for being here.
I am so excited. I have the privilege of introducing today's speaker and... I feel like I have the best job there is for Silverton Health. I get to work with the community, I get to do all these amazing things, but internally I get to work with our leaders. I get to work with leadership and I get to make really great relationships with them. So, you know, sometimes when you work with leaders, you hear things like, you know, lead with courage. You need to be a leader that inspires and engages. And today I get to introduce someone who is that person. She inspires me. Woo, I get emotional. Every day. She's courageous, and I just can't even tell you, when I go to her clinic, she's a clinic manager, she is smiling, she's brave. She has this work ethic, and you just like fall in love with her every single day, and I love that about her. So whenever I see her, I think, I want to be just like you when I grow up. I really do. So with that being said, I would like to introduce Heather Soa, our clinic manager for Mount Angel Clinic.
Running for a cure since I was 15 years old. I've covered many miles, raising funds, collecting donations, and supporting research for a variety of both physical and mental illnesses over the past 20 years. I never thought any of this would benefit me specifically, though. My husband noticed the lump in my left breast this past August. I dismissed it. I'd never done a breast self-exam in my life. Never considered myself to be a candidate for any kind of illness. I was a healthy mom of three, a wife, a nurse, energetic, hardworking, enthusiastic. In essence, I felt I was untouchable. My husband encouraged me to see my primary care physician. I hesitated, thinking that the lump was nothing. But to ease his mind, I went ahead and saw my provider, and she didn't believe that the lump was nothing. So she ordered a mammogram. The following 3 months passed in a somewhat surreal state as I had the mammogram, an ultrasound, a biopsy, a CT scan, an MRI, a lobectomy, a re-excision, and then this last December I had a mastectomy. And then a tumor board met to discuss the pathology of the tumor, giving me a dual diagnosis of both a ductal carcinoma and an interlymphatic cancer. The dual diagnosis would require 16 weeks of chemotherapy, a total of 3 different drugs, and then 1 month of daily radiation, which I just found out this week that I don't have to have the radiation. I asked for a second tumor board to take a look at my pathology, hoping that chemo was maybe not the only answer. And though I was resistant to the idea of spending 16 weeks in chemotherapy and treatment, I agreed with both tumor boards and began the treatment shortly after Christmas. And the really good news in all of that is that the tumor was hormone receptive, giving me a really good prognosis. So I started right after Christmas. My fear was not specifically for myself, but for my children, and then for my brother and his kids. I had genetic testing done at the recommendation of my provider. The results would tell me things I may not want to hear, but that I must. The 2-week wait for the answers crawled by when the genetic doctor in California finally called to discuss what she had found. My family rejoiced with the news that I had no disrupted DNA that could cause my children to develop cancer later on. Having spent 2 years working toward a dual master's program in healthcare administration and nursing, I understand the value of evidence-based practice and the research that's behind it. I spent those years doing research of my own and compiling data to sustain my thesis. Now on this cancer journey, I have more opportunities, doors have opened for me to participate in research now. When I was seeking out an oncologist to take my case, I found Dr. David Page of Providence Oncology. much younger than I am. He looks like he's 12, but he's fantastic. He's an experienced oncology doc. He came from the Mayo Clinic, and then he does half-time research for Providence. So he gave me a couple of options as far as research I could participate in. I chose to take part in a study of the immune system response during the various phases of chemo, and I was able to start participating with my very first chemo treatment. And all I really have to do is give extra blood. So every time I go in and give a couple extra vials, he's able to look at my blood under the microscope, and he can use the information that he gathers from my case to help other people in their treatment later on. It's specific to breast cancer. I have an opportunity to participate in a second study that is ongoing, beginning with the oral Taxol medication that I will take for 10 years, and that will start this spring. I have cancer. I don't define myself by cancer. I am a woman of faith who very strongly believes that this is an opportunity for me to learn, to help other people, and to grow as a person and in the Spirit of God. There is a scripture I've always embraced and taken both literally and figuratively. Hebrews 12:1 says, "Let us run with endurance the race that he has set before us." This is my race. It's long. It's got a lot of hills and not very many water stations and rest breaks. It's tough and it will try me, but I'll be better for it by the end. I will have experienced something that I can share with others. My case is a classic breast cancer. It's the most researched and most well-known cancer as far as diagnosis, treatment, and probability of reoccurrence. There are so many other cancers out there that do not have extensive research behind them for an oncology doc to confidently treat. These are the people we should be walking and running for. These are the people we raise money to support research for. I have a close friend who has a cancer so unique that there's only one trial medication available for him. When he's finished, he doesn't have any other options. Dr. Gordy Cladd initiated the Relay for Life when he spent 24 hours rounding the track at Baker Stadium at the University of Puget Sound in 1985. He logged over 83 miles in those 24 hours, and he raised $27,000. The next year, 19 teams joined him. They raised $33,000. We are fortunate for Dr. Cladd's ingenuity and motivation to raise money for this cause. He since passed from heart failure following stomach cancer. We have the ability to carry on his mission and legacy by participating in the Relay for Life here in Woodburn. I'm proud to be a part of the search for a cure for cancer.
Thank you for sharing your story. We hear so many stories just like that. Today I'd like to introduce our new ACS partner, Lisa Martinez. And Lisa's going to share with you what we do with the money that we raise and how it goes to benefit the cancer patients.
So this is the question that we get, the number one question that we get from people that don't know what Relay is or don't know where your money goes for the American Cancer Society. So I'm going to go over this a little bit. So, wrong way. I'm technically challenged, and I'm an ugly crier, just so you know. If you tell me your story, I will cry, and it will be ugly. But hopefully you'll ugly cry with me. Okay, so 2015, all of the relays in the United States, we had 47,000 overall events right here in the United States. 3 million participants, 135,000 Relay for Life teams, 275,000 cancer survivors were celebrated. That's huge, 275,000. That number was not the same in 1985. So we've definitely made some progress. Since 1985, we've raised more than $5.65 billion. Is that a joke?
Yeah.
Yeah, billion. Not million, but billion. But thing, we always get that question, where does the money go? Where does that money go? Does it go to the staff? Not living in a mansion. Gonna tell you that right now. I got 5 relays in my portfolio that are this size or bigger. So thanks to you guys, 19,306 cancer patients in the Great West Division. So that's Alaska, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, Nevada, and Montana. 19,306 cancer patients in our division got rides to treatment. So your money provided people to get their rides to their treatment. If they didn't have anybody to take them to their treatments, couldn't afford the taxi or the cab fare to get there, you know, that money went to those people in your area, right here in Woodburn. Maybe not all of it, but a good portion of it. Thanks to you guys, cancer patients received 8,210 nights of free lodging through our Hope Lodge or through our hotel partners. We don't have a Hope Lodge here in Portland, which I'm praying that we will have enough money to build one because they are amazing. We have one that just opened in Salt Lake City. It is gorgeous, state-of-the-art, great place to go if you need to have cancer treatment in Salt Lake. There'll be a place for you to stay for free that will feel like home, because there's nothing worse than having somebody have to come into town, leave their home and everything behind, and not be able to afford housing. I know a lady personally said, we get choked up, here I go, cry with me, I'm like, no. I know a gal that her son is a three-time cancer survivor, and they filed bankruptcy three times because they didn't know about this program. What? Just simply, if they could have had a hotel room, they would have helped them. It's crazy. So the third time, she actually got free lodging, which was awesome. So you can see, this is a very old picture of an office. Does anybody remember this? This is going to date me. Like, my first office job, people were smoking all over the place. Do you guys remember that?
Oh, yeah.
So American Cancer Society has went up to Capitol Hill, and because of your guys' money, we have been able to cut smokers by 50%. And we have gotten them out of our offices, we've gotten them out of bars, we've raised the prices, the tax prices on cigarettes, so that maybe our kids, they won't fall in our kids' hands. Because I don't know, how many of you guys have seen the price of cigarettes? And I'm gonna be completely honest, I smoked back in the day. And I remember going, oh, when it's $1.85, I'm quitting. And now they're like $6 or $7 a pack. It was crazy, right? Yeah, I had a number. I wasn't actually a real serious smoker, obviously. Once it hit that number, I was like, I'm never smoking again. And I did. Thank goodness, because now we know better. But my mom's generation and her mom's generation, they didn't know better. So thanks to you guys, we've been able to do that. Thanks to you guys, we have been able to celebrate so many more birthdays. It's all about cancer survivors, right? You guys saw that number of how many cancer survivors we've celebrated over the years. Because of the American Cancer Society and your funds, we are able to provide the research that is needed to come up with these new treatments. Because chemo and radiation aren't the only answer. There's gotta be something better out there. There's gotta be something better out there. But it takes a lot of money to go to these researchers for them to do their job to find the cures. There is no cure right now for cancer, but there are a lot of really cool things that have come from the American Cancer Society. We have a vaccination now that was funded by the American Cancer Society for HPV. Do you know, most people think, what is HPV? Everybody thinks it's kind of this sexually transmitted terrible disease. It's not. I mean, it is, but it's not because you're dirty. Everybody gets it. It's just some people don't have the gene that it takes to fight it off. I'm an HPV cancer survivor. Had I known that I was lacking that gene back in the day, I probably could have done something more to prevent it, but maybe not. Now, though, with the vaccination, my daughter's not going to have to worry about it, because I lovingly passed that down to her. She got all the worst parts of me, so she says. So she got vaccinated. So if you've got kids that are, you know, 12 to 18, get them vaccinated, because that is going to stop 12 different kinds of cancer. It's very, very important. So our relay in all of our, in the Woodburn area, it represents hope, it represents community, it represents friendship, passion. What else does it represent? What does it represent to you guys? Survivorship. No, no.
Life.
Life.
Happiness.
Happiness.
Love.
Love.
Tears.
It's like my number one favorite emotion, tears through laughter or laughter through tears kind of thing. It's without you guys, there wouldn't be the money for the research, there wouldn't be the money for the rides, there wouldn't be the money for the hotels and the lodging, there wouldn't be money. I don't know how many of you guys know that we have a program called Look Good, Feel Better. So there are there's paperwork all over the place. Make sure you pick that up at the front desk, because it's in English and Spanish. It shows all the different programs and services that the American Cancer Society provides here in your city. And we have Look Good, Feel Better, we do wigs, we do turbans, hats, skin care. It's all free to cancer survivors. People don't know this. So here is, on your table, this is your guys' cancer plan. How many of you guys have insurance on your homes? How many have car insurance? How many of you guys have, and the school teachers probably have this, a fire plan? If there's a fire in your house, where do you meet? Everybody have that? Well, we didn't until my then fourth grader came home and said, we have to have a plan. And I was like, okay, let's get it. It was part of our homework. But this is your cancer plan, and anybody else around you's cancer plan. Take these cards. I will make more. Well, I won't make more, but I'll order more. They have not only our 800 number on them, which these people that answer this phone 24/7, they have all the answers for you. Anything you have a question about, call this number. You'll be amazed at the free stuff you can get out of that.
You get free massages?
Maybe a relay. You'll have to come and find out. And there's cancer.org. It's the number one website for cancer research. If you Google some kind of cancer, you don't know what you're going to. You do know this, that not everything on the internet is true. Yeah. Or everything you read on Facebook, not always true, right? But you can go to cancer.org and you can know that if it's posted there, it's been researched 20 times over and backwards, upside down, every which way. So it's proven. It's good information. I just had a really good friend diagnosed with thyroid cancer. Cancer.org is where I went, got all the information I needed, called her up, said, I got a plan. And she was like, great, because I'm not even looking, because I'm going to pretend like I don't have anything. And I said, oh yeah, you know, I'm coming, we're going to the doctor, we're going to get everything figured out, I got it all, I got your plan. And she was like, I'm glad you got my plan, because I don't even want to think about it. She just had a baby 2 months ago. But we got a plan. This is her cancer. So take these cards with you. If you need more, come see me. I got a whole pocket of them. They're scattered around the tables. And make sure, you know, if you're on social media and you see somebody needing a wig or needing a ride, this is the number you give them. Do you guys know the number by heart? What? I didn't hear it for a long time. But it's 1-800-227-2345. 227-2345. Important number. Back to you.
Mike. So with that, Rhonda,
has agreed this year to be our finance person. Our goal is $70,000. Sponsorships. We've all heard about our sponsorships. Woodburn has some of the most generous people that you will ever meet. Our businesses, the city, everybody is just fabulous. And with that, I'd like to give Bill a minute to talk about sponsorships.
Anybody knows anybody that'd like to be a sponsor of your business, if you work at a place, talk to your boss to see if they're interested in being a sponsor, and then maybe you can start a team in that business. My goal this year is 80 sponsors.
One of our sponsors has been the Woodburn Independent. For those of you that did not pick up the Woodburn Independent this week, please do so. It has a beautiful article all about Bill and his sponsorships, and it will give you a lot of information on how important these sponsorships are to our relay. Our media contact will be Gina Uffridge. Do you want to say a few words?
Sure. Do you want me to come up there or just speak loud?
Good. Your choice. For those of you that don't know, Gina is a former chairperson. She passed the torch. If I had known better, I'd have been running.
And we passed it to two very successful people, so thank you. So as we progress through the Relay for Life season, we definitely want to be a resource for you as a committee to help you promote your fundraising activities and anything that you're doing in the community. So we have a Relay for Life website that we maintain. My husband James takes care of that. He will talk about a text app that we do as well. We have a Facebook. I don't own a Facebook, but we do have somebody who's going to maintain that for you. And then my contact is the partnership with the Woodburn Independent and making sure that we publicize all of your fundraising events, making sure that our team meetings are also posted, and we'll have all of that and current information on our website as well. So we will make sure that you have our contact information, that you can send us an email, you can text, whatever works for you. Thank you.
Thank you. Look at there. Text messaging right afterwards. James. Look at there. Old school poster.
Yep, I made one in the third grade. First off, everybody, I just want to say thanks for coming out today. I know it's a nice day out. We're going to chat here as soon as we can, but thank you for giving up a Saturday morning. Those of you who rely on this texting that I do occasionally, I try not to inundate you with things that you don't want to know about, but for the last week, the site has been down. So that's why you did not get any reminders or anything about this. But for the most part, I only am limited to like 120 characters, so you're not going to get a whole bunch of rambling tech stuff. I'm not going to sell your number to anybody. I'm not going to spam you with anything. I'm just going to tell you updates of what's going on, when meetings, reminders, that type of thing.
Hey, James, when's the drive bill?
That's coming up.
Bill, that's coming up. I'll tell you shortly.
Okay.
Like in 5 minutes.
Dawn, I believe Sheila has agreed to do this again.
Yay.
In 2016. Now I put her on the spot. You know, when we're out there at Relay and we are dog tired, some of us have passed out and we're asleep, Sheila is going. She's going all night. She's the one that's out there keeping us motivated, keeping it exciting, keeping the message out in front. Without Sheila, it just would not feel the same. And we really want to take a minute and recognize Sheila. We want to thank you for your help last year, and we're looking forward to working with you again. And the microphone is yours.
How many years have you been joining?
This is 2016. Gina, 2007?
2008, yep.
2007, somewhere around there. And I said, what is it that you do? What do you want me to do? And of course, I always end up never doing just what I'm supposed to do. but thank you very much. It's quite a job, you know, for such a horrific disease. Heartbreaking, wrenching, intense emotions. We rise above that on that weekend. We walk through that pain, the people that are still suffering, and we rise above that in celebration of what we're here for and for the survivors. And I really, really enjoy the work that I do at Relay. And it's a kick in the pants for me to have you say, Sheba, would you have this song ready for the Survivor Walk? And every year it's something different. You have a song that you want me to play for you, all you have to do is email me, okay? And let me know what that is, and I guarantee you I'll have it blaring over the field. It's a tough job to get the proximity of the sound system, because I provide all the sound system and do that engineering. But to get the sound, so I don't want anybody over on the other side, you know, missing anything, to be heard, because everything that I'm told to say is important. That's quite a job, and so I always tactically challenge myself every year to get all those logistics correct, and every year I add to that system to make it better for you. So this is what it's all about, and I sure do appreciate the opportunity. Thank you.
Logistics, let me come over here. You guys have heard me joking about my mic. My mic has agreed to do logistics again. He's going to need a logistics team, so if you're interested in logistics, you want to say a few words?
No. I am looking for some volunteers to help. It's logistics is putting the whole thing together, tables, chairs, canopies, getting power, garbage, just everything that you need to get put in place and have ready to go for everybody to have a good time. And so
these are the behind the scenes guys. They make everything seamless. So Luminarias, would you like to say a minute? Would you like to say a few words?
You know, earlier today I was talking with Lisa, our staff partner, and she said there are only three things that Relay for Life requires you have at your relay: opening ceremony, luminaria ceremony, and closing ceremony. Luminaria ceremony is I'm gonna get choked up. It's a huge ceremony that is so it's intense. Thank you, Sheba. And it's a powerful, and it just is such a great way to pay tribute to the people we've lost to cancer, the people who have survived, and the people who are out helping people move forward. So I encourage everybody to stay for the Luminaria ceremony. We've been starting between 9:45 and 10. Short ceremony, we'll get those bags out on the track. And again, it's powerful. And it's uplifting. So please, I encourage everybody to come out for that.
Once again, we're going to have a silent auction. Misty, you want to say a couple words about the silent auction?
Yeah, I'll just stand as well. James and Gina got me doing the silent auction about 3 years ago. And the second year my mom was diagnosed with cancer, she did pass, but it was a peaceful situation for her, so it was all right. But this is kind of my thing, is to help with the silent auction. So we just have, each team tries to donate a basket, and we try to raise money towards our committee to just increase our number for that $70,000 goal. So I would just encourage anyone to, if you can't walk or participate, if you want to donate a basket, just see me. Thank you.
One of the big parts of Relay is, of course, our celebrating our survivors and celebrating our caregivers. And so we always try to have some type of survivor dessert and some type of survivor dinner or event at Relay itself. And last year, Walt Mangridge and Ruby Wolfer took on that role. Walt's going to come back, and Sharon Schaub has agreed to help Walt. You want to say a few words, or are you just...
I'm just so excited to be involved with the survivor activities, mainly because my granddaughter is a cancer survivor. My aunt passed with cancer, and it's affected my family, obviously. And for me to be able to help out in some small way by being involved in this, it warms my heart, and it just makes me appreciate everything that Relay for Life does. Thank you.
We are looking for somebody that's interested in picking up the catering aspects of it. We try to have a dinner for the survivors, but we also want to make sure that the Relay participants have food available, and we try to put on a nice dinner. So if you are interested in helping us with our catering, or if you have an idea, or if you know of a restaurant that would like to step up, please give Mike that information. Or on your tables, there are little cards with Mike's phone number, my phone number, and our email address. So please take those cards, and if you have any questions, if afterwards you think, oh, I'd really like to help with X committee, just give us a call or shoot us an email. Lori last year did a great job with the Snack Shack. She brought a bunch of kids. I think Chevelle here helped with the Snack Shack. They had a lot of fun. There's no cost. If you want to make a donation to the Snack Shack, that's fine. But if you just want to come out and you're walking and you need an apple or you need a snack or you need something to drink, we've got the Snack Shack open, and Lori's going to do that again.
And it's all free.
And it's all free. You know, we accept donations, but we don't want anyone to feel like they can't participate because they can't afford it. So last year we had a nice kids zone. We showed movies, we had face painting, we had a full area stocked with games and things for kids. If anybody is interested in maybe being a committee chair for the kids zone, we could use that. If you have a name, you want to volunteer somebody, again, those cards on the table, send us an email.
And I might say real quick, too, on things like the kids zone and stuff, we have a lot of stuff on hand. We have games. We have a lot of face painting and a lot of stuff on hand. So if it's something you'd be interested in doing, don't feel overwhelmed that you have to go find everything and make it all happen. We have names and phone numbers of past companies that have helped, and we have a lot of stuff in storage that can be used again this year. So, you know, just don't feel like you're starting from absolute ground zero.
You know, and that's true for any of these committees. If you want to volunteer and you only have an hour a week, or you only have a half a day at Relay, or you want to take on this committee, we can use a wide range of help. And we have a lot of those things in our back pocket. We just need somebody to coordinate it. We don't expect you to go out and reinvent the wheel. We've got, did you see all that big list of committee planners? There's a lot of people in this room that can help you out if you do want to step up. We need a volunteer for entertainment. The entertainment person is going to work hand in hand with Shiva, make sure that we have a lot of activities. We've had some really great local bands in the past. We've got those names on speed dial. We just need somebody to take on and coordinate that. We've talked about a Bark for Life. We didn't have it last year. Dog and a ball. Last year you may have noticed my dog was at Relay. He will not be at Relay this year. Right after Relay, we found out he had cancer and he passed. So, you know, it just doesn't affect
us. It affects our little ones too. It's a horrible disease, and that's where my tears are coming. We lost Natchez in August. So, with that, I'm going to turn it over to James.
Thank you.
A lot of us look forward to this. This is a great fundraising event. While James is walking up here, I'm going to draw a name. 798. Hey, that's my address.
Yes, this year, April 30th, the Woodburn Fire District headquarters station up here on State Highway 214 will be the annual Relay for Life yard sale. Those of us that have participated the last few years know that Do It Best is a big sponsor. We've also been in sponsorship with the Woodburn Independent on this. The last couple of years, we've gotten hundreds to thousands of people that come out to this. I think last year we raised about $8,000 in 6 hours. That was with 28 pallets of merchandise that we had donated from Do It Best. Well, don't tell my boss, but we're up to 48 pallets right now. So, if you're in a market for a table saw or a shop vac, I've got probably 60 table saws. Somewhere around 40 shop vacs, toolboxes, you name it. My employees really get behind this at Do It Best, and they're looking forward to coming out on April 30th. It's also any team that wishes to have a spot out there. The good news is we'll get people out there. The other good news is if you bring your stuff, people might buy your stuff as well as our stuff. And whatever you collect from your stuff goes towards your team. Whatever, of course, Do It Best sells. Plus, we also have credit card capabilities. So, again, April 30th. I always recommend you tell your friends early instead of getting out there, getting what you want, then calling your family and friends. share the love and just tell everybody April 30th. It's tentatively supposed to start at 8:30. I know people start lining up about 6, so. April 30th is the big yard sale at Woodburn Fire District headquarters station up here on Highway 214. Thanks.
All right, I want to reiterate two things. 48 pallets. Mike,
so far.
Don't listen. 48 pallets. They take Visa. Bring your card with you. And I'm going to turn it over to Cleo in just a second. She's going to talk about fun run. This year, we are kind of splitting up the duties a little bit. I'm going to be focusing more on the committees, and Cleo has stepped up to focus on our teams. This woman is a phenomenal fundraiser. I want to be sure to be able to say that. Where are you at, Cleo?
There you are.
She's a phenomenal fundraiser. Her team really gets excited, and I am so happy that she's going to come up and start getting our team captains a lot of that same information and getting them jazzed. Christian does the fun run. We've had that for a couple years. It's a lot of fun. I'm going to let her talk a little bit more about what's happening with the fun run this year.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming, and I'm going to try to get this quickly as possible so you guys can get on with your day. So the fun run began because my brother Chris, he was a teacher at Woodburn High School, and then now he's somewhere else. But what his idea was, I'm a teacher. I don't have time to be sitting around with all of you overnight and, you know, hanging out with you. And he thought, well, let's do something that some people can maybe have 30 minutes, an hour, that they can still feel good about their participation with Relay for Life. So that's how the fun run started. So our first fun run was about 3 years ago, so we'll be doing our fourth fun run this year. Every single year we have learned something new from that run. Everything from forgetting to get bibs to having water available. It's become a situation of chaos, and now it's been in more of an organized chaos. But the fun run, we're going to be doing a 5K, a 10K. This year we're hoping to add a 1K. We're also going to be moving it so we're not out in at the park isolator. We can move it up to the walking area to start there and finish there. I think that will get all the runners that come and their families that come more involved in the actual relay, and also being able to provide some special prices for the people that win. We have some runners that are serious runners, and then we have people that just want to go there and have fun and walk. So this is a fun run walk, okay? It's supposed to be fun. So you don't have to be a person that likes to do half marathons. You don't have to be fast. You just need to come and have a good time. We typically have charged $20 for the entry, and I believe we're going to be keeping the same price. However, we haven't set that up yet. But that gives you a t-shirt. So last year, the first year, we just gave out leftover t-shirts, the cotton t-shirts. The next year, we had a purple t-shirt that my model right there, Jacqueline Flores. And then the last year, we had the pink t-shirts, and they're all a dry fit material. So it's a really nice shirt. What we also found out last year was that people didn't want to run or walk. They just wanted the t-shirts. So we thought, okay, fine, we'll just sell you the t-shirt for $5 less than what it would cost for the actual you walking and running. And people were willing to pay those $15 just for the shirt. This year, if anybody knows my brother, Chris, he's very good about sales and getting out there and, you know, getting people excited, but he's not really good about the details. So, and that's ends up falling into the responsibility of our team, which is pretty much our family. So therefore, last year, through another friend, Angelique sort of got introduced to our family. We sucked her in. We pulled her away from the Chimawa Relay for Life, and this year she's totally committed to the Woodburn Relay for Life, and she will be part of our team, and she's going to be helping Chris ground him and help him move forward, and we're really excited about that. So, So why we relay? My mother-in-law is March. This is March Bielefeld. My mother-in-law. She was diagnosed with ovarian cancer in June of 2010. And that's not her real hair. That is a cat hair type thing that she found. And that year, we went through a lot of different treatments and doctor's appointments and three surgeries. And then in 2012, around June, she comes to me, she says, she says, I went to this relay, and I had really no idea what it was. I knew people at work had talked a little bit about it. I donated some money, sure, here I'll donate this much to you, whatever. And she came to me about a month before with the Woodburn Relay, and that was the last year that it was at Woodburn High School in 2012. And she said, I want to have a team. What do you think about having a team? And I was wanting to support whatever she wanted to do, and I said, sure, you can have a team. What do you want me to do? And she's like, well, I will take care of all the stuff, because she was retired, and I was still, you know, I was working, and she just told me what I needed to do, what she wanted, and I said, okay. And then she said, maybe your family wants to join. So I told my family about it, and of course, they've known Marge forever. My sisters were like in middle school when I started dating her her son, who was 17. So she'd always been a maternal figure, not just for myself, for my siblings. So the entire family decided, yes, we're going to do this. We will join you. We will help her. We'll do whatever it is that she wants to do. So in that short period of time, our team raised just over $1,000. And we thought, well, that's pretty good. I think that's a pretty good amount of money. We got really excited about it that year. If you were part of it, it poured a rain that year. It was the most miserable rain ever. In 2013, we did it again, and we raised over $5,000. In 2014, we raised over $11,000. And last year, we raised $9,800. And I still have some money at home that we never turned in, because we wanted to have a little bit of pot to get us moving to this year. So, because I'm not comfortable asking people to give me money. I have a hard time saying, hey, do you want to donate some money? I have a hard time with that. So So what we do as a team is that we give them something for their donation. So how we do that is that, by the way, this is our team. We have a trophy, which we forgot to bring. My sister wanted to bring it and parade it around. So how we do that is we have fun. We really have a good time, and we try to have as much fun as possible when we have when we do our events. We get on each other's nerves, but ultimately at the end, we do what we're we need to do. So we do garage sales. We participated in the Duet Best garage sale, and our last year we got scared about the rain. We didn't show up, and then the sun came out, and we were very disappointed. But this is a great opportunity in the garage sales with Duet Best because all the people come. So if you have friends, family members, coworkers, say, hey, do you have any stuff? Clean out your closets, give me whatever you want to give me, if you would like to donate. And people will give you books, will give you stuff, and you know, price it so cheap that you can sell it. We also, well, whatever we have left over from that garage sale, we just keep adding to it, and we end up having several garage sales throughout the year. We also do face painting the day of the event. My sister-in-law, Robin Villafil, who also happens to be my co-captain, she does an awesome, she's an awesome artist. And that was the first year this, she made this great face on my son, David, made him into a beaver. That was the first year. She quickly learned that she couldn't get that intricate with the designs because it would take forever. Plus, you had a line of kids ready to do that. So as time has gone by, we learned that it's better to do something simple and quickly. And that year was the year that it rained, and we had kids lined up at 6 in the morning on Saturday wanting to get their face painted. Without coffee, my sister-in-law said, I'm not open yet. So, what is really important as well is we try to develop, let me go back a little bit here. We try to develop relationships with different friends that we have that have businesses, or they have a special store or anything that they have available to us. And Robin had a great connection with Runaway Crafts in Salem. That is an artistic store. They sell paper. They sell all kinds of stuff for anything artistic. And the last 2 years, her name is Christy. She has offered to allow us to have a stamp-a-thon for 2 days. People will come and pay for the weekend. You have an entire 2 days of uninterrupted time to scrapbook, to do cards, to do anything that has to do with arts and crafts. You come and work on your own. Robin has been able to get some donations from different vendors for prices for us to give to people. Last year, even the ladies that came decided they were going to help by bringing snacks to share rather than us providing the snacks. So it's very important to try to develop those relationships. Fill the bucket is probably the easiest way to get money, especially if you have cute kids. And we try to use our kids as much as possible. We have the kids from the age of 2 and you know up. So we really use those cute little dimples on my nephew Javi to make sure we get some money from people. It's usually set up from 10 to 1 and then from 1 to 4 o'clock, and you can pick out a time, and then Gina later, I think Gina's doing that this year again, she will give us a schedule when we can sign up for that. And really, you can make a lot of money just standing out there and asking people for donations. So we'll talk about that more later in other captain meetings. I was talking earlier about partnerships. One of the other things that we have done in the past, along with the Runaway Crafts Stamp-a-thon Marathon, is that we have also ended up connecting with Grandma Jan's Cookies. In the last 2 years, they've been able to come out and be part of Relay and also be a partnership with us and trying to help us raise money. La Margarita Restaurant in Salem, she's a good friend of mine. Without really asking her if she could help me out, she was more than willing to give us some money as donations, and she's always been a great supporter of that. We also have the West Coast Window Tinting. He's always been willing to help out. He has a business in Brooks. And I say these names because I think it's important for you guys to know who has been a good supporter of the American Cancer Society as a whole, not just our team. And so it's nice for us to be able to support those people as well. The half penny last year allowed us to have a concert. My sister-in-law knew a musician. They were willing to provide to do a concert for a few hours. People would come in, give a donation, and we ended up making some money. One year we did an 80s dance, which we didn't have a lot of turnout, but we had a great time. We all got to wear our old clothes and, you know, the 80s and get our hair up and have a good time. For some of us, it's about the trophy, and that is a big deal for my family, which some of them are over there in the corner. And we are very competitive. The one year, we had not done a lot of fundraising early on. We got a late start, and the after-school club had over $2,000, and I think we had $500. My sister, Mari, who works at MAPS, said, we cannot let those after-school kids beat us. How can we let those after-school kids beat us? That's how serious it gets with us. And so, of course, it's like, there's nothing to worry about. You know, the kids are going to be done by the end of the school year. We'll still have another month. And so ultimately, of course, we ended up raising the money. But that, I'm saying that just because you get you to understand how important that trophy is to some of us. So this was taken the second year that we participated in. We've had the trophy for 3 years. If you want to get that from us this year, have to step it up. because we don't really always have goals, but one of the things is that I'm not a person of goals because I never want to fail, so I don't set goals. So I just like, whatever comes, it comes. And every year we manage to do really well. And it's not anything special that I do, it's really my family. Without them and without their support, and then pulling some close friends who, some of you have not known my mother-in-law, but they know me, they know my husband, and just that connection gets them. As a captain, what you want to do is you want to share your story, you want to tell people why this is important to you, why do you want to do this, why gets you to want to spend months of fundraising and weekends fundraising and then spending an overnight in the cold camping, why is that important to you? And if you share that with people, they're going to want to have that same passion as you do and want to help you either by participating or by giving you a donation or by guiding you to someone who can give you a donation. So those are things that are very important. My mother-in-law passed away in August of 2013, she passed away right after her second relay. And this was so important to her. And one of the things that she really wanted to do, because she knew that she wasn't going to get better. After so much time, she knew that. And those were the hardest conversations to have during her treatments. But one of the things that she always wanted was to be able to find a cure, especially for kids. That was always such a heartbreak for her when she would see children or hear children having cancer. And she wanted to make sure that she did her part, knowing that it wasn't going to do anything for her, but she wanted that to leave something behind. And the promise that I made to her in one of her treatments was that I would do and I would continue to fight in her name and in her honor. In whatever way, shape, or form I can do that, I will continue to do that. In October of 2013, we also lost her brother to cancer. To lung cancer. And then in January of 2014, we lost my grandfather, who was in his 90s. He lived a very long life. Ultimately, what we found out is he passed away of lymphoma. And I really believe that if he had lived here, and we would have found the lymphoma much sooner, he could have lived much longer. So that's why really is important to me. That's why really is important to my family. And I just want you to take from this is that personalize it. Don't be afraid to share your story and your passion of why you do this. Because at the end, if we're not able to save the loved ones that we have in our homes and those people that are there to support and try to keep alive, there will be somebody else's mother, somebody else's sister, somebody else's brother, child, cousin, friend that you will be able to help. So think about that. It only takes two people to be a team. You can ask the wonderful ladies at Senior Estates who's cooler than I here today. But even if it's just two of you, come and have a good time. Invite people to be part of this. Tell them why it's cool. Tell them why it's important. And just have fun. It's about having fun and being together. Thank you.
So as you can tell, this is a very passionate type of activity. You know, people get involved for different reasons. I have to be honest, I first got involved just because I thought it was a neat community event. I walked that very first relay in the rain at the school, freezing to death, passing the baton, scared to death that, oh my gosh, we don't have somebody on the track. What are we going to do? I'm here to assure you that we no longer have the baton police. The goal of Relay, like they said, we want the opening, the luminary, the closing. But the goal is to have fun. It's to raise money for a very worthy cause. It's something that brings our community out, brings our community together. Because if you stop to think, cancer doesn't discriminate. Just about everybody in this room has been touched very closely by cancer. When I first started relaying, cancer wasn't on my radar. I had no body in my family with cancer. I didn't have any friends. I didn't know anybody. Unfortunately, I can no longer say that. Over the last couple of years, that list has grown. And so, like with Cleo, you know, I can't help the people that I've lost, but I can relay to help the people tomorrow, to help the future, to help the children that are growing up now, and really stamping out this horrible, horrible disease. Another thing that we do is the Kiwanis Mustang for Dornbecker's Children's Cancer. And in 1975, I believe the cancer survival rate was less than 25% for most of the children's cancers. And now you're up to like 80%. And that's because of the work that we've done here. That's because of people getting out and walking in the rain, passing a baton, or lighting a candle, lighting a luminaria. So with that, let's see, what do I want? Relay Recess?
Yeah.
Relay Recess? Where did that go? Relay Recess was on the slide, but please.
Well, that's okay. Well, it kind of fits in with what Cleo was saying and what you had said. So Relay Recess doesn't happen at Relay for Life. It happens in the elementary schools, and the kids do fundraising. So the $2,000 or $3,000, whatever we raise each year, is from elementary kids. Their main fundraiser is a penny war. So they war against each other and they sabotage each other with silver coins. So you're more than welcome to join in. We usually do that the last week of April. But what I want to say is, last year when we, the kids all get to do a luminaria bag, we supply the bag, American Cancer Society supplies the bags, and everyone gets to do a luminaria. So we have different people that come in and talk to the kids about the importance of it and why we do that. And last year, after the little spiel and the kids had their bags, this one little boy raises his hand, teacher, and I go over and he says, I don't know anybody that has cancer. And I thought, that is why we relay, so that next year we have more kids that say, I don't know anybody that has cancer. Anyway, so Relay Recess is awesome. We will get you postcards about when they're happening. You're more than welcome to come attend. It is like a mini relay in that it's a party. The kids do a luminaria walk. They play games. It's a lot of fun. We have survivors come in to share a little bit about their journey, so kids can have a better understanding of how cancer affects people. But you're more than welcome to come and help those kids raise money, too.
When is that?
We usually do them the Thursdays in May, and it's after school at 4 o'clock, so we have a different school each Thursday.
We're not chasing y'all out, but we are getting ready to wrap up. And I want to take a few minutes to thank some of our key sponsors. Today, I really want to give a hand to Silverton Health and to Renee. I don't know if Renee can hear us, but Renee is the woman that has put out that beautiful spread for us. She's helped set up this room. Silverton Health donates these facilities. They've donated breakfast. Like I said earlier, they are a wonderful sponsor. So if we could just give Silverton Health a round. You've heard about Do It Best. Do It Best is another fantastic sponsor. Their garage sale. The City of Woodburn has donated the use of Centennial Park. We don't have to pay for any of the permits. We don't have to pay for any facilities or anything like that. They give us a tremendous amount of support, and we wouldn't be able to do it without the city. And we have a city councilor, Sharon Schaub, here in the audience. And those of you that have helped with the logistics, Republic Services, not only do they donate the garbage service, but they have decided they're going to donate the cans, so we are not having to lift and carry garbage this year. We're just going to roll carts, and they'll dump them straight for us. Those of you that own businesses, you might be seeing Bill at your doorstep. Thank you, Bill, for all your support. I'm going to do a quick drawing. You see that there's still a number of things here on this table. We will be doing drawings and giveaways at our committee and our team captain meetings, so please come to our team captain meetings and our committee meetings. We will be meeting here next Thursday. The first meeting is at 7 for committees, and then at 7 and 8 for teams. And then the fourth Thursday of the month, 6 to 7 for committees, 7 to 8 for teams, yes. Thank you for keeping me honest. So, next Thursday, 6 o'clock, committees, 7 o'clock for teams. Then we're going to meet the fourth Thursday of the month. And then in June, we will have two meetings in June right before relay. So, with that, I'm going to do 5 more raffles. Get your tickets ready. 794. All right. 794.
794.
795.
Last thing we're going to do is play the video. Those of you who were at Relay last year may remember my daughter ran around and filmed just about everything she could, about 6 or 7 hours worth of recording. And then with the help of WACAT here in Woodburn Community Access TV, her and Moises down there put together this video. It's on YouTube. It's also a great way to promote your team or get your team excited. So tonight, or today, those of you who've seen the camera back here, we're going to replay the kickoff on WACAT in the next upcoming weeks, probably once a week for the next couple weeks. So if you have friends that missed today, by all means, if they have Wave cable, channel 5, they can look and watch everything that we've done today. But if you haven't seen this video, it is pretty awesome. So with that,
I'm getting to the last one. Keep talking, Nate. What's your question? You know, I have it all set up, of course.
There it is.
Well, I had it all set up.
show our support for those who are fighting cancer, as well as those who have lost the fight or their battle has ended to cancer. And it's just a way to show respect for those people and just to keep pushing on towards hope of finding a cure.
But a lot cooler than it sounds.
What's the relay mean for you?
Huggies.
So many friends and people that have cancer, and it's time to find a cure for it all.
Why do you relay?
Why do I relay? Basically because I lost my husband, and I have lost family members, and 3 weeks ago I found out about my great niece's son. They just found out he had brain cancer, he's 8 years old, and hopefully we can find something for him before it's too late for him.
If you haven't registered for your team, we've got Rhonda in the back helping people register. We've got our ACS partner here. She can answer any questions. On the table, you've got the contact cards for Mike and I. There is plenty of food. Please, Silverton Health does a great job, and we want to make sure that we're thanking them by eating the food that they provide us. So you are welcome to stay and visit and talk. Maybe try to form a team. have some more breakfast, have some more coffee, and Mike and I and the other folks wearing red shirts will be here for a while longer. We are happy to sit and answer any questions that you might have. Thank you all for coming.